gonna be all or nothing. There's 15 problems, it's gonna be 2 points each. That's 30 points of the test right there. Okay, so what is the limit of a sequence? Well, as the terms of a sequence, here, let's look at an example. One, let's look at an easy one. How about a sub n equal 1 over n? What would be the limit of this sequence? Well, if you write out the terms, plug in 1, plug in 2, plug in 3, plug in 4, plug in 5, and so forth, it looks like the numbers are getting closer to 0. But how do you know it's 0? How do you know it's not like 0.001 or negative 0.001? How do you know it's 0? Well, think of the graph. If you think of the graph of y equal 1 over x, it's the same thing. What is that? By the way, what's the only difference between these two? How do you graph y equal 1 over x? Come on, that's a base graph, right? It's like this and this. The only difference between this and this is this one, the domain is all real numbers, except, of course, 0. But remember, when you have a sequence, the domain are the positive integers because there's a first term, a second term, a third term, a fourth term. So if you just plot the positive integers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, you can actually think of the graph. So basically, if you have a graph of a sequence, and by the way, your calculator can graph a sequence, right, if you just punch it in, you can see that these dots are getting closer and closer to what number? Well, it looks like 0, but how do you know it's 0? Well, what did we learn when we studied rational functions? How do you find the horizontal asymptote of a rational function?
With the power.
If the degree of the bottom is bigger than the top, then the horizontal asymptote is y equals 0, right? What if the degree of the top is the same as the bottom?
One.
And you look at the coefficients. And then what would happen if the degree of the top is bigger?
Long.
Yeah, well, then there would be like a slant asymptote like this. But then what does that mean? That means the numbers are getting bigger without bounds, so the limit would be infinity. So that's the first category. So when you have a limit like this, what you want to do is you want to categorize it. Like, if I see this, I'm going to do this. So the first one is like a rational function. So let's say we do something like this. 2n plus 3 over 5n plus 7. Without drawing this graph, what would be the limit of this sequence? As the graph is going out to the right, the y-coordinates are getting closer to what number? Two-thirds would be the answer. How come? Because if you were to graph this, and again, think of it like this then if you have to. What is the horizontal asymptote for this graph? If the degree of the top and the bottom are the same, you look at the coefficients. So y equal 2/5 is the horizontal asymptote. So basically, when you're finding the limit of a sequence, as the graph is going off to the right, you're basically looking for the horizontal asymptote. That's what you're trying to find. So what if I gave you something like this then? What about 2n plus 3 all over n squared plus 1? What would be the limit? If the degree of the bottom is bigger than the top, then it's 0. But that kind of makes sense because if you plug in really huge numbers for n, the denominator is simply way bigger than the numerator, right? Like if you plug in a billion, isn't a billion squared way bigger than 2 billion? Yes. And then what would happen if the degree of the top is bigger, like 2n squared plus 3 over n plus 1? What if the degree of the top is bigger? And like I told you, you would divide, you get a slant asymptote, so the graph is going to keep on going up without bound. There's no horizontal asymptote, right? There's a slant asymptote. So that means it's going to infinity. Now, this is the easiest one when you have a rational function, but do you really think I'm going to give you a problem like this? A sub n is equal to 3n squared plus 4n plus 5 all over 4n squared plus 5n plus 6. What would be the limit of this sequence? We just talked about it. If the degree of the top is the same as the bottom, you look at the coefficients. 3/4 is the limit. The limit is the same thing as, take, like this, taking the limit as n approaches infinity. Have we had experience with that? Yeah, when we did exponents and logarithms. Remember the one you had the Lomi and massage? Well, we're going to see it again now. Anyway, if you took pre-calculus regular, yeah, you probably get plenty of these. But we're in honor, so it's probably going to be something like this. C sub n is equal, okay, let me think of something. How about sine inverse negative n, how about negative 3n squared plus 4n plus 5 all over 6n squared plus 7n plus 8. So don't look at the sine inverse, just look at the thing in the parentheses. What is the limit of this thing? If you plug in bigger and bigger numbers for n, these numbers are going to get closer to what? Negative 3 over 6, right? If the degree of the top and the bottom are the same, you look at the coefficients. Negative 3 over 6, of course, reduces to negative half. So this gets closer and closer to negative half. Therefore, the whole thing gets closer to sine inverse negative half. So the limit would be sine inverse negative half, but you would not get credit for that because you didn't simplify. Sine inverse negative half. Sine of what angle is negative half, but you have to be in the range. So could the answer be 7 pi over 6? No, because that's not in the range. Remember, the range for sine inverse is from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2. So what is the answer? Negative pi over 6. See, so this chapter is going to be difficult because you got to know base graphs, you got to know things that we learned before. Okay, I think we better do another one. How about something like this? D sub n is equal to, how about tan inverse square root of n squared plus 2n plus 3 all over 3n squared plus 5n plus 7. Okay, don't pay attention to the other stuff. Just look at this. When you see a rational function, your eyes should just go right to the rational function. What is the limit of that thing that I just circled over there? 1/3. Okay, that's easy enough. Therefore, the whole thing will get closer to tan inverse of the square root of 1/3, which of course is the same thing as tan inverse 1 over root 3, which is a number that we're supposed to know. Tangent of what angle is 1 over root 3, but you got to be in the range? Pi over 6. Okay, so that's the easiest one, the rational function. Basically, when you see a rational function, you just compare the degrees of the top and the bottom. You know what? I think we got to do another one. What about E sub n is, let's go cosine inverse. How about n squared plus 3n plus 4 all over n cubed plus 2? Okay, don't pay attention to the cosine inverse. Just look at the rational function part. What is the limit of that? If the degree of the bottom is bigger than the top, the limit is going to be 0. So this gets closer and closer to 0. Therefore, the whole thing will get closer to cosine inverse 0, which is? Okay, cosine of what angle is 0? The answer is pi over 2. See how you gotta, you gotta know stuff. Okay, that's the easiest one, the rational function. Okay, let's look at the geometric sequence here. How about something like this? A sub n is equal to 1/2 to the nth power. Now, when you first see this, yeah, I don't know, Mr. Park. Well, if you don't know anything, write out a few terms. What would be the first five terms? Plug in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1/2, 1/4, 1/8, 1/32, 1/64, and so forth. Now, it kind of looks like these numbers are getting closer to... Really? 0. Yeah, the limit is 0. Okay, let's look at another one. What about negative 1/2 to the n? Okay, plug in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. What do you get? Negative half, positive 4, negative 1/8, positive 1/16, negative 1/32, positive 1/64, and so forth. Now, these things are going negative, positive, negative, positive. They're alternating. But just because it's alternating, though, is it still getting closer and closer to some number? Yes. What number is it getting closer to? Zero. So the limit for both of these are zero. So we can kind of generalize. Anytime you have r to the nth power, this is a geometric sequence. Anytime you raise a number to the nth power, it's geometric. If this number is between negative 1 and 1, you know, just like here, what do you think the limit is going to be? And can you see why it's going to be 0? Because when you raise fractions to higher and higher powers, they get smaller and smaller, right? Right? We learned that. So if you see this, it's 0. What if r is greater than 1? Okay, let's look at a problem. C sub n equals 2 to the nth power. Let's write out the first 5 terms. Plug in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 2, 4, 8, 15, 32, 64, and so forth. Are these numbers getting closer and closer to something? No, they just keep getting bigger and bigger without bounds. So we say that the limit is infinity. Right? Doesn't that make sense? The numbers just keep getting bigger and bigger without bound. So, if r is greater than 1, the common ratio is greater than 1, the limit is going to be infinity. Now, what would happen if r is less than negative 1? Let's look at it then. For example, negative 3 to the nth power. Let's write out a few terms. Plug in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Really? Negative 3, positive 9. Negative 27, positive 81. Negative 243, positive 729, and so forth. Does it look like these numbers are getting closer and closer to anything? No. But can we say the limit is infinity? Well, starting from the second term, all the even number terms are going to the infinity, but all the odd number terms are going to negative infinity. So what do you think the limit should be? The limit does not exist because it's not going to anything. It's jumping around. It's not like these numbers are getting going to positive infinity, but some of these are going to positive infinity, but some of them are going to negative infinity. So did you guys ever see the movie Mean Girls? You know what? I'm going to show you the video. Basically, they said if the graph or whatever, the numbers don't approach anything, the limit does not exist. Wait, I gotta look for it. Where's my math photos and videos? Mean Girls.
Thank you.
number between negative 1 and 1, greater than 1, or less than negative 1? Now, Mr. Park, how come you didn't include when it's 1 or negative 1? Because, come on. Like here, what if you just add 1 to the n? What is the limit of that? Yeah, it's 1 because every single number is 1. 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. It's not just getting closer to 1, it is 1 all the time. So the limit is 1 because it's 1 all the time. But what happens if you had negative 1 to the n? Then you would get negative 1, 1, negative 1, 1, negative 1, 1. Is it getting closer to anything? No, it's not. So what, by mean girls, the limit does not exist. So this one would be 1, and this one would be does not exist. Okay, now, if you were in pre-calculus regular, then this is the kind of problems they give you. They give you like this. Oh, 1.1 to the n. What's the limit? Hey, that number is bigger than 1, so the limit is infinity. Or they'll give you something like this, b sub n, negative 0.3 to the n. Oh, that number is between negative 1 and 1, so the limit is 0. But come on, this is pre-calculus honors. Do you really think you're going to get numbers like that? And so, look over here, if you look. So where do you see a number to the nth power? Like here, here, a number to the n, and then here, 10, 1. So three of them right there. So you, what you have to do is you got to figure out, is that number between negative 1 and 1, bigger than 1 or smaller than negative 1? Well, the first one is easy, pi over e. Well, pi is 3.14, e is 2.72, so I think this number is bigger than 1, right? So easy. But what about natural log 2? You guys remember?
0.693.
Hey, somebody remember. Natural log 2 is approximately 0.693 because everybody here took chemistry, right? Or AP Chem or something? Or just because you know math?
Physics?
Oh, physics? So you guys did this in physics?
Yeah, the constant half-life formula.
Okay, there you go, physics student. Or how about just do this? Reference it with numbers you know. What is natural log 1? Okay, look, what is the base that's not written?
Zero.
E to the what power equals 1?
0.
Okay, wow, took us that long to figure that. What is natural log E? E to the what power equals E?
1.
So, E is about 2.72, so therefore, shouldn't natural log of 2 be somewhere in between there? So even though you don't know 0.693, you should know it's between 0 and 1. So therefore,
the
answer would be 0. What if you had natural log 3 to the n then? What if you had, okay, see, natural log 3 to the n, which is going to come up later. Well, if natural log e is 1, 3 is bigger than e, right? E is 2.7, remember? Andrew Jackson, the 7th president of the United States. Oh boy, we're not going to get into that again. Anyway, natural log 3 would be bigger than 1 then, so therefore the limit would be infinity. So, whenever you have a number to the nth power, that's what you gotta do. You gotta figure out what the number is. Okay, next one. Base graphs. Uh-oh. That's why, again, in fact, if you could graph all of these, you would just look at the graph and see what happens as the graph goes out to the right. Is it getting closer and closer to something? But a lot of these, you just don't know what the graph looks like. Okay? So let's start off with an easy one, I think. A sub n equals sine n. What does that graph look like? So you got to ask yourself, do I know how to draw this graph? Okay, you better. Anyway, sine looks like this. As the graph is going out to the right, is it getting closer and closer to something? No, because it's just oscillating back and forth, so the limit does not exist. If it doesn't approach anything, the limit does not exist. So the answer would be does not exist. I will accept D and E as does not exist. Actually, when you take the AP exam next year, you cannot abbreviate, you know. So you would have to actually write out the word does not exist, unless you have a legend on your paper. So you could put like D and E means does then. Do we know what the graph of tan inverse x looks like? No, of course, if I draw it for you, everybody's gonna get it. The thing is, you gotta draw it. So remember I told you when I graph the inverse trig functions, I remember the range first, negative pi over 2 to pi over 2, and then I think of some points on the graph of the regular tangent function and I switch it. That's what I do. I don't know what you do. Maybe you guys just memorize the graph and that's why you can't remember it now. That's the graph. So look, as the graph is going up to the right, is it getting closer and closer to something? Yeah, it's pi over 2, because that's the horizontal asymptote. So the answer is pi over 2. Pi over 2 is the limit. So the category is base graphs. So like where on here do we see base graphs over there? H, K, well I just did K for you, and L. Okay, this one's gonna come up a lot, you know. So we know sine n just oscillates between negative 1 and 1, so the limit doesn't exist. But what if you had sine n over n? Remember how we graphed this? Why do I keep saying that? Remember how sine oscillates between negative 1 and 1? So if you have a 1 there, then it's just going to go between negative 1 and 1. But then you have this here. So what it's going to do, it's going to oscillate between 1 over n and negative 1 over n. So if you graph y equal 1 over x and negative 1 over x, what happens with the sine graph? It goes like this. It oscillates back and forth, but look, the amplitude keeps getting smaller and smaller as we go to the right. Remember we did this in the trig chapter? So even though it's oscillating back and forth, what do you think?
Zero.
It's getting closer and closer to zero. That's because you keep dividing by bigger and bigger numbers, where this one, the amplitude stays the same between negative 1 and 1. It's not going to get closer to anything. But since this one, it's getting the amplitude keeps getting smaller and smaller, this one is getting closer and closer to zero. Okay, you might want to remember that one. In fact, you got to remember all of these. Okay, next one. Let's review something from when we did logarithms. What is the limit as n approaches infinity? Because when we find limits, that's basically what we're doing. We're finding the limit as n approaches infinity. Of 1 plus box over n to the nth power. You guys remember?
X.
E to the x. Okay, you're going to have to know this though. Okay, so let's look at a problem. What is the limit of, how about, now we're just going to go straight to the hard one already, because we did this back then. You guys just probably forgot. So when you see something like this, okay, can I do this? Is this legal? Okay, look at that. Isn't that a rational function? Yeah. The degree of the top and the bottom are the same, so what's the limit? You look at the coefficients. 1. So this gets closer and closer to 1, and 1 to any power is 1, so the answer is 1. No! That's because this is going to infinity. You cannot treat infinity like a number, because it's not a number. Like if it was 1 to the second power, that would be 1. 1 to the seventh power, that would be 1. But this power is going to infinity. So 1 to the infinity, you can't do anything with. So what you have to do is you have to use this. Is there a way I could make this look like this?
Negative 1.
Yeah. What did we learn in the logarithm chapter? What's the first thing I should do?
Flip.
Hooli. You hooli it. Can I just flip it over like that?
-1.
No, but you gotta put the -1 in the exponent, because -1 means 1 over, right? And then now lift and separate. In fact, this is a technique we use in calculus all the time. Lift and separate. Whenever you see a single term in the denominator, lift and separate. So what is this? N over N, which is 1, and then 1 over N. Hey, it's starting to look like that. But then, Mr. Park, I just need an N there. So you put the N there. This is called lomi-lomi. And you put the -1 on the outside because you would multiply the exponents, right? Isn't this the same thing as that? Okay, now look at the thing in the brackets. 1 plus box over n to the n. What is the limit of that?
E to the
box. So the thing in the brackets gets closer and closer to e to the 1. is here, that's the power of E. Therefore, the whole thing will get closer to E to the 1 to the negative 1. So if you multiply the exponents, you get E to the negative 1. So the limit, so if you were to graph this on your calculator, for example, you would see that the graph kind of looks like this. If you graph this on your calculator, it looks like this. Let me see. I guess it's getting smaller. So the graph looks like this. But then you're not going to be able to tell what that number is. It's actually like 1 over E. You guys even remember what 1 over E is? Approximately 0.367. See, that's why. You can draw the graph, but you're not going to be able to tell. Maybe if you saw it in the table, would you even recognize 0.367? I don't know. Okay, I'll stop. Okay, so, and then, ooh. What would happen if both the top and the bottom both go to infinity? Like, for example, something like this. What if you have n squared over 2 to the n? Right, because n squared. What does the graph of y equal x squared look like? Doesn't it look like this, y equal x squared?
Yeah.
What about y equal 2 to the x? 2 to the x is an exponential function. It goes like this. So look, as the graph is going out to the right, see how it's going to infinity? This one is also going to infinity. So they're both going to infinity. So what do you think?
Infinity.
No, because some infinities are larger than others. You watch The Fault in Our Stars. Some functions just go to infinity faster than others. So, Mr. Park, how can I tell which functions go to infinity faster? Well, luckily for you, we have a mnemonic for that. It's called n to the n pfeffel. You're going to need that in BC calculus, n to the n pfeffel. If you go to AB calculus, then you only have to know apple. But we're training for BC calculus. You're going to have to know n to the n pfeffel. So, these tell you which functions go to infinity faster than others, because they all go to infinity. So the slowest growing one is the one on the right. L stands for logarithmic. No, that's not how you spell it. Okay, what does the graph of a log function look like? Doesn't the log function look like this? Like natural log x? See how it's going? There's no horizontal asymptote. It just keeps getting bigger and bigger, but very slowly. That's the slowest growing function we know that goes to infinity, the logarithmic function. What do you think P stands for?
Polynomial.
You guys even remember what polynomial functions are? X to the first, x to the second, x to the third. You need more examples? X to the fourth, x to the fifth. These are polynomial functions, like y equals x squared or x cubed. They go to infinity, but look, you can see it goes faster than logarithmic. What do you think E stands for? Exponential. Exponential functions would be like 2 to the x, 3 to the x, 5 to the x, e to the x. You see the difference between the two? This is polynomial. When you have variable to a number power, exponential is when you have a number to the x power. So exponential functions, they go to infinity faster than polynomials. F stands for factorial. You guys know what factorial is, right? Factorial, if you were to graph it, goes to infinity even faster. And then the fastest knowing function that we know, growing function, is n to the n. It doesn't stand for anything. It stands for n to the n. So if you were to graph x to the x power on your calculator, the thing would go to infinity even faster. So just remember, these are the slowest growing ones. These are the fastest growing ones. So let's go back to this problem. What do you do when you see both the top and the bottom going to infinity? You ask yourself, what is that? Polynomial. What is that? Exponential. Which one goes to infinity faster? Exponential. So common sense. If the bottom is just simply way bigger than the top, what do you think the limit is? It's zero. And what would happen if the top is growing faster than the bottom? Then the limit would be infinity, right? should do is write out the terms, because maybe you can figure that out. I'm not gonna do it for you. So whenever you see certain things, then you gotta do, see, like, for example, I guess the first thing you should ask yourself, like, hey, this one, do I know what the graph looks like? Because like I told you, if you know what the graph of all of these looks like, you don't have to do anything. Just look at the graph. What's happening as it goes on to the right? What is it getting closer to? But unfortunately, we don't know how to graph most of these. So that's why we gotta use these other techniques. All right. One more thing. Number four. What time is it? If we run out of time, then you're just gonna get to look at your test. Okay, let's look at the, okay, first of all, what are these numbers? Zero, no, one. I'm gonna keep bringing this up over and over till you get it. What are these? The triangular numbers. Okay, so you know that the triangular numbers, what's the explicit formula? Okay, for those of you who refuse to memorize it, then this is what you gotta do. What did I teach you? Because you're gonna do this on the test. Look at the differences. What do I have to add?
Two, three, four, five, six.
Now look at the difference of the differences. One. If it takes two levels to get to that constant difference, then what do? We do the method of finite differences. We know that the formula is gonna be what? If it takes two levels? Second degree polynomial. So an squared plus bn plus c. Okay, now what do I do?
Plug in.
You plug in numbers. If I plug in one, you should get the first term. If I plug in two, you should get the second term. If you plug in three, you get the third term. And then you solve those equations. So yeah, if you want to do all that work, go ahead. I don't really care. But I'm telling you, it's a lot easier if you just memorize the darn thing, because it's going to come up over and over and over till you finish your math career. N times n plus 1 over 2. It's just a lot easier, but it's up to you. I'm going to leave it up to you. How many times do I have to see it on a test before you actually think, I think this is important? Okay, but that's the explicit formula. What you're going to do tonight is you're going to write a recursive formula. So, on the test, or I don't know if we're having a second quiz, but you guys got to check. A1 is equal to 1. I'm going to write a recursive formula. An is equal to An minus 1 plus box. Fill in the box. That's what's going to happen on the test. So, this is a pretty easy one. And then we're going to work our way up to harder and harder ones. So what? Okay. I'm going to tell you what to do. Just do exactly what I do, and then hopefully nobody will get hurt. This is what you want to do. A2 is equal to A1 plus something. A3 is equal to A2 plus something. A4 is equal to A3 plus something. And A5 is equal to A4 plus something. Fill in these numbers, and hopefully you will see a pattern. But of course, if you don't fill in the numbers correctly, you might not see a pattern. What do I have to add to the first term to get 3? 2. What do I have to add to 3 to get 6? What do I have to add to 6 to get 10? What do I have to add to 10 to get 5? Now look at these numbers in the parentheses. Is there a pattern to that, or these are just random numbers? There's a pattern. I can't believe some of you are thinking, is it random? Of course it's a pattern. Okay, now how do you express this pattern in the box here? Now look, hey, that's arithmetic. Okay, that's easy. If it's arithmetic or geometric, we have formulas. But then, what happens if it's not arithmetic or geometric? Then you gotta do some work. Okay, anyway, but this is arithmetic. What's the common difference? One. So you write 1n, and then you adjust. Okay, let's see if you can do it. N plus what? Very good, it's n plus 0. How come 0? Because the first term is 2, Mr. Park. Should it be n plus 1? No, because in a recursive formula, the first term, see, the first term is given. See, if you plug in 2, you want to get 2. You understand? In a recursive formula, the first term is given. We are starting from the second term. See, if this is 3, that's 3. If this is 4, that's 4. This is 5, that's 5. So that's why it's just n. It's not n plus 1. Does everybody understand that? In a recursive formula, you start by plugging in 2, because the first term is given already. So this would be an example of an easier one, and then I think tonight one, I think there's still arithmetic, so it's not going to be that difficult. All right, let me pass off the test. Any questions on this? And then look over here. Look at problem J. Mr. Park, what about all these factorial things? I told you when you go to BC Calculus, you're going to have to work with factorials. So what you need to do for this problem is you got to simplify it. And then once you simplify it, it's really easy to find the limit. But that's the thing. You got to learn how to simplify expressions with factorials. Okay, let's turn this off.